Hi there, everybody, and thanks for joining us here on Facebook Live with the candidate. I'm joined by Republican candidate for governor, Frank Edelblue. Good to see you.
How are you, Josh?
I am doing great. How's everything going in the campaign?
It's going awesome. I think you've probably noticed that we've had some really good events happen for us in the last week.
Yeah.
You know, picked up two solid endorsements, won two solid straw polls.
Yeah, that's good news. And people are now starting to really get engaged. You're about to find out. This
good.
Facebook thing has been pretty successful. How are you when it comes to the whole social media world? Are you on Twitter and
absolutely on Twitter? And I work as an investor in technology startups, so I know a lot about technology.
Right, that's right. For people who don't know your background, what is it when you talk about the business?
So, all the way back. So,
and sure, whatever.
So I'm an accountant.
Yeah.
Started my career at a company called PricewaterhouseCoopers. Auditing companies around the world. I'm a trained CPA, helping them with like waste, fraud, abuse, operational efficiency. Left there, joined a company as a chief financial officer. Early on in that stint, I discovered some problems in the company that I knew I had to do something with, so I went to the board of directors, and I ended my relationship there. And then really, I got to live the American dream, which is I started a company at my kitchen table. Company grew to over 800 employees, operating in over 20 countries with tens of millions of dollars in revenue, and had the opportunity to sell that in 2009. And then I continue to this day as an investor to help companies grow, like early stage technology companies, to grow and create jobs.
Yep. Now taking on the next part, next chapter. Questions are already starting to come in, so let's
get
it going here.
Thank you.
Amelia, she wants to know, with Mike Pence's selection as VP, his law defending religious liberty is again. Same with this here. It keeps jumping on me. Sorry about that.
That's okay. Technology.
I know. I got it. Okay. So with Mike Pence's selection as VP, his law defending religious liberty is again coming under attack from Democrats. If you were governor, would you sign a bill similar to Indiana's that would allow businesses to consider their religious beliefs when considering whether or not to serve someone?
Yeah, so I absolutely believe in the concepts and the principles of religious liberty. I think that these are baked into our Constitution and that they are no way that we can skirt around that. I am not familiar with a specific law in Indiana, so I would have to take a look at that law, but I'm a staunch defender of religious
the
liberty.
Concept,
the
think
concept of religious liberty, I think, is an important one for our constitutional republic.
Okay, so there you have it. Next question coming from Stephen, Department of Education. According to the New Hampshire Department of Education, average salary for a teacher in New Hampshire is about $56,000. Do you think New Hampshire teachers get paid too much, or what should they be paid?
Well, it's funny, when you get into the government realm, what I've discovered is that compensation works under the system of wink and nod, which is basically like, I will underpay you now for a better pension in the future. And I really think we need to break that down, and we need to pay people what they're worth. What does the market demand for wages? And that's what we ought to be compensating people.
Okay, Jonathan, I see your question in here. I'm not really understanding what it is. If you want to restate it there, I'll try to get to it. Next question, though, John Cameron.
It's like a lightning round, isn't it?
Kind of. I mean, these people are paying attention now.
Good.
They're engaged. You got to be on your toes. So what are your stances on legal marijuana, similar to how Colorado has done it? And obviously, we're talking about recreational marijuana versus the medical.
Yeah, so I think in New Hampshire, we need to decriminalize marijuana and make sure that our law enforcement resources get focused on higher priorities in the state.
Say, when you say that, I mean, are you open to the concept of...
We don't want to go too far.
Right.
Like, let's start with decriminalization. Let's decriminalize marijuana, make sure law enforcement gets focused, and we'll see where we are.
Okay. So, but you haven't closed the door on it. Because a lot of people are saying, you know what, in a heroin epidemic, how can we even be talking about legalizing? But you see there's a lot of daylight between the two.
I do see there's a lot of daylight between the two. And I also know, particularly, I'm happy that we finally have gotten some medical marijuana into the system. You know, we passed that. It took a long time for that to get implemented. But I think medical marijuana, we know that the studies will tell us, help people deal with pain. And so maybe they're going to be using medical marijuana rather than opiates, and that could prevent people from becoming addicted.
Sure. All right, next question coming in from Rick. Do you think the state should fund Planned Parenthood? You knew that was coming.
Yeah. No taxpayer funding of abortion providers.
And how big of an issue do you think this is going to be moving forward, especially talking to the conservative voters?
Well, I think it's an issue for the Democrats that they want to continue to make it an issue. But really, abortion is such a divisive issue in our state. We just need to don't muddy it up by putting taxpayer money into that.
All right. Next question. Do you think, how would you go about luring big businesses, companies into New Hampshire?
Yeah, so I mean, the way that businesses are going to come into New Hampshire is when they perceive that we've got an environment that is going to be conducive for them to be able to grow and expand their operations. We need to deal with the skills that our workforce has, absolutely. We need to deal with our healthcare costs, the highest healthcare costs in the country. We need to deal with electricity costs, which are fourth highest in the country. And we've got taxes. We continue to have the highest taxes of all of our New England neighbors. So why would somebody come here if we know that their cost structure is going to be higher? And finally, we just have regulation that is stifling business. So if we can fix those five things, we can create an environment in which businesses and honestly individuals, you know, people are willing to lay down their hard-earned money to try and start businesses and grow businesses in the state. And when they grow, they create good jobs, and good paying jobs is what we want.
And a quick follow-up, I asked this to Jeannie Forster the other day. She said biotech is, the state's ripe to bring biotech, more biotech here. Any other industry that you think that
So I probably would disagree with biotech. I don't see that as a flourishing opportunity in our state, but I see us capitalizing our advanced manufacturing capabilities that we already have in the state.
Okay. Next question is coming from Cassie, and I'm not skipping you guys out there. I'm just, as it pops up, there we go. Cassie wants to know, do you support drug testing for welfare recipients?
Yes.
Well, pretty clear and concise there.
Any questions?
Lightning round, that's good. All right, next question. It will be, as New Hampshire takes on the new vaccine registry, do you think the state should also follow California's new law in removing religious exemption for vaccines in order, in order to participate in public school and childcare? You want me to read the question again?
Vaccine registry. So I will tell you that I think that we need to create more options for parents so that they're not forced into vaccine registries and they're not forced to participate in vaccine programs.
Okay. Kyle wants to know, talk about corruption in New Hampshire. I'm not sure what that question means, but in government, do you think there needs to be more transparency?
Well, again, so I spent 8 years at PricewaterhouseCoopers as an auditor, you know, working with large organizations to root out kind of waste, fraud, abuse, the kinds of things that he is probably talking about. So not only do I know how to recognize them, but I know how to find them when they are a problem. And so certainly, you know, in an Edelblue administration, we will not have, you know, those types of activities taking place.
Cody wants to know how you would deal with the Democratic majority in the executive council if there was one.
Yeah, the same way that I deal with everyone, which is you get along with people, you find common ground, and you work to solve the problems for the citizens of New Hampshire.
All right, fair enough. Isaac asked this question before, so you're going to get it again. Budget experts and economists have found that Donald Trump's economic plans would add over $24 trillion to the national debt and blow a $10 trillion hole in the deficit. Why do you support someone who proposes policies that are so fiscally irresponsible? Now, obviously, he has an opinion about that, fair question.
Well, and he has a presumption of support as well. So what we have, though, is, you know, under 8 years under the Obama administration, we have the worst recovery that we have had since the Great Depression. You know, so there's one candidate in this race who's ever created any jobs. And what I will be focused on is not the national economy, but making sure that the New Hampshire economy works for New Hampshire families so that they can get good paying, high wage type jobs.
Tracy would like to know, and this is kind of a federal level issue, but obviously input is important all across the board. What do you think we should do to reform welfare and Social Security disability? And that, obviously, it is, as I pointed out, a federal issue to a degree, but Medicaid expansion is here.
Absolutely.
And there's a lot of debate.
So I think really what we need is the problem with a lot of our welfare programs is they create these, we believe that they're a safety net, and everybody, I think we all believe in a safety net to help people who are down on their luck. But what we do is we construct these policies that create a security fence that has the effect of locking people into poverty. I mean, relative to Medicaid expansion, in 1985, we had 3.5% of our population who could not afford their health care costs or their health insurance, and so they were covered under Medicaid. Today, now 14.5% of the people of New Hampshire cannot afford their health care costs and cannot afford health insurance, and so they're having to be covered under some type of a welfare, Obamacare welfare expansion is really what they're covered under. This is a failure of the system because it locks people into this stasis of poverty, because if you earn that next dollar, you lose your benefits. What we want is everybody to have skin in the game so that they are lifted out of poverty, not stuck in poverty.
This isn't really a question, it's more of a statement, but it's one that I've asked the candidates before, talking about the low unemployment rate in New Hampshire, yet all the Republican candidates for governor say the economy is stagnant and headed in the wrong direction. How do you make the case that, you know what, it can be improved, and we got to fix it.
So really what we've got is we have 2.6% unemployment, very, very low unemployment. And again, as you described it, some politicians are running around the state, they pat themselves on the back and they tell us how great it is. But we rank 39th in terms of GDP growth. We rank 49th in terms of productivity growth. Salary increases come from productivity growth. And so we've got some structural problems in this state that are preventing businesses from growing and providing employees wage increases and, you know, salary increases because of promotional opportunities. We've got to get business in New Hampshire growing again.
Have I asked you about a casino? Are you in favor of expanded gambling?
So there are certain types of gambling that I like. I voted against one of the gambling bills and two of the other ones.
Cody wants to know how you would tax expanded gambling and where those funds should go. Is it a general fund issue or is, let's just say, you know, in a vacuum, if we were to bring a, if the legislature were to legalize
it, Cody, I'm not sure that I know the answer to that, but I'm going to tell you that education and infrastructure would be two of my high priorities.
Okay. And Patrick follows up to another question and says, you say you are for drug testing welfare recipients. The question is, you have no concerns that other states that have implemented such laws have lost money, finding less than 1% are failing drug tests. I'm not sure about the stats. This is the question that's coming in, but I get the gist of it.
Yeah, so I mean, if you think that I'm wrong on that policy, I'm happy to look at other studies that are out there. But my understanding is that drug testing ensures that welfare recipients are basically not breaking the laws while we're providing for them.
Well, thanks for the question coming in there. Next question, what's your opinion on raising the minimum wage? That's from Cassie.
Yeah, so what I want to do is raise the maximum wage. What we really need to focus on is not minimum wage, but wage growth for people in New Hampshire. Again, coming back to this question earlier, we're at 2.6% unemployment, but we're 49th in terms of productivity growth. You know, the way that people get wages is more per capita output. So what we really need to do is if we focus on that, minimum wage is going to be a moot point.
Interesting question here coming from Don. What about expanding farming and the excessive excessive regulations on our farmers? Where do you stand on farm and food freedom?
Yeah, so support farm and food freedom, and I'm happy to announce that I am a founding member of the Beefield Farm CSA in Wilton, New Hampshire. For those of you who don't know what a CSA is, it's called Community Supported Agriculture, and it is a local farm in our community that provides food for everyone in the area.
Interesting, good stuff. Maybe this guy's narrowed it down to two in the governor's field, Republican field. Andrew wants to know, would you say the main difference is between you and Jeanne Forrester? We got him on this one.
So I
know it's rapid fire and it's coming on all different areas.
No, not
areas
a problem.
There,
but what I would tell you is that it's going to be about experience. I mean, so I know something about business, about growing a business and creating an environment in which people want to invest and grow and create jobs.
Obviously, we spend a lot of time talking about the crisis of addiction here in New Hampshire.
We do.
And a lot of people are obviously very concerned about it. According to polls, it's the number one issue facing the state. What would you do differently? And I'm asking this.
So step one is, what I would do is I would frame the conversation differently, because I think what we do is we look at the drug dependency as the problem, when in fact that's a symptom of an underlying problem. And so we tend to focus on how do we treat the symptoms, and if we don't solve the underlying problems, we're not going to really solve the long-term problem that we're having. And so we got to recognize this is a community problem. I mean, it starts with a drug-dependent individual, the family is affected, the neighborhood is affected, the town is affected, the county is affected, and the state is affected. You know, the state does not have fairy dust that they can sprinkle on this problem and make it go away. We all have a stake in how we're going to fix this thing. And so I think the main issue is, like, let's focus on the root cause, the drivers of the problem, and solve that, as opposed to throwing money at a symptom.
You already mentioned that you were in favor of decriminalizing marijuana. Getting a couple of questions, so I'm going to follow it up here. What about growing it?
So part of decriminalization, I voted for a bill that would have allowed up to 6 plants for individuals to grow at home.
Okay. Do you believe that, obviously, we're here in New Hampshire, first it was civil unions and we legalized same-sex marriage, but I guess philosophically, Naomi wants to know, do you believe that marriage is between a man and a woman?
So I do. I think that there's a special sacred, and when I say that, I pull in the religious context between a man and a woman being joined before God. I don't really think that the state has a role in the contractual aspect. Well, the state has responsibility for the contractual aspects, the church has a responsibility for the religious aspects, and we've pretty much settled this issue in New Hampshire.
Yes, done deal, as far as you're concerned. It's not an issue. All right, moving forward, next question. Do you view internet service, this is interesting, do you view internet service as a public utility?
I don't view it as a public utility. I view it as infrastructure in terms of, you know, economic opportunities that are afforded because we've got good access throughout our state.
All right. And talking about the infrastructure, got a lot of questions on that recently for these folks. What do you see as the most important issue? And I'm kind of just lumping a bunch of them together when it comes to the infrastructure.
So we have to have good roads so that businesses are able to transport products in and around the state and in and out of the state. So I would say that our roads and our bridges are one of the key things that we need to be focused on.
Okay. Position on assault-style weapons.
Can I back up one second?
Sure.
The other thing that let's focus on airports as well, because the Manchester Airport has not been performing well in terms of passenger embarkments. We're down, significantly in terms of the number of people who are using that airport. And an airport like that should be an economic engine for our region. And I don't know if we're using that to its fullest extent right now.
Would you be an advocate for trying to make it an international designation?
I would absolutely support international, but I think as well we need to make sure that it's integrated into the business community in a way that it becomes an asset or a better asset for the state.
Now, one of our users are asking about assault-style weapons. What can be done from the state level, do you think, when it comes to protecting the Second Amendment while finding the balance of keeping the guns out of the hands of the bad guys?
Yeah, so I think that we have a Second Amendment that protects the right of people to bear arms, and that, in the Constitution it says this shall not be infringed, and I think we need to respect that. We've got laws in place, and let's just make sure we enforce the laws that we have.
Okay, back to this is the nature of the beast.
Back to infrastructure.
How'd you know? How do you fund all the improvements? Brian wants to know if we're talking about a hike in the gas tax.
Yeah, so not necessarily a fan of a hike in the gas tax, but what I would tell you is that what we need to do is focus that infrastructure is kind of like marketing expense in a company. And in marketing expense, you have to prioritize that, because if you shortchange marketing expense over time, soon customers aren't coming back. And it's the same thing with infrastructure. We need a good infrastructure, and it's an investment in our future. So we need to keep making that infrastructure on a continual basis and not create a seesaw effect where we invest and then we don't invest and stuff like that.
Okay. Andrew would like to know, how do you keep the younger generation here in New Hampshire rather than moving to other states for better employment? This is obviously a big issue.
It is. So three of my kids have graduated from college, and they would all love to be back in New Hampshire, but we don't have good paying job opportunities for them here in the state. So one ended up in, took a job in Chicago area. Another took a job in the Washington, D.C. area, just out of in Northern Virginia there, which is honestly where most of your money is being spent these days. And the third has what I call the consolation prize of New Hampshire economic opportunity, which is Boston, kind of close but no cigar.
Rick's giving you some love, saying, I like this man. He has all great answers. Just figure I'll throw that
out. Thank you, Rick.
Joel Prescott, how will you help mentally ill people in New Hampshire? What kind of resources will you provide? Huge issue.
It is a huge issue, and actually we've provided more funding. I think what we're finding is that the government has been very inefficient in terms of getting those resources deployed into the market to try and deal with some of the problems. And this is really comes down to the role of the governor. I mean, so I'm not running for the legislature. I'm not running for Supreme Court Justice. I'm running for governor. And as governor, my responsibility is to take the business background that I have, the experiences that I have, plus the experience that I have in the legislature, and make this state perform like nobody's business. In other words, we should be getting things done more quickly for the people of New Hampshire.
Steve would like to know, would you allow Syrian refugees into New Hampshire?
Well, so first of all, I may or may not be allowed to
make that determination.
I mean, that's a federal issue that what you're talking about. But what we can do, we do have some issues on the state that we can do. You know, we don't want, terrorists coming into our communities, quite frankly. And we know that oftentimes the immigrants who are coming in are not able to be vetted, and they're not getting medical screening as well. And so I think those are some issues that we can deal with at the local level, and that would be the responsibility of the governor, so that we protect New Hampshire.
Talk about energy.
Yes.
Whether we're talking about Northern Pass or natural gas, where can we go in order to lower that bill every winter that hits New Hampshire? Families right in the pocketbook hard.
Yep. So we have made some long-term strategic missteps as a state. And so there's not a quick solution to this in terms of how you're going to fix that. But what we need is we need a sustainable long-term program that gets more energy into the market so that we can get the cost down. And I think that this is going to be an essential part of trying to keep manufacturing companies in our area, because they're being lured by states like Georgia and North Carolina with far cheaper, and I'm talking, a third of the cost of New Hampshire energy costs in those other states. So it's a big problem for our manufacturers.
Where are you with Northern Pass?
So Northern Pass, I actually had the opportunity to sit down with PSNH the other day, because I do think it needs to be buried. I think it needs to follow the right of ways. I think we need to try and negotiate something that benefits the people of New Hampshire. They came out with their power purchase agreement just the other day, and I sat down and I walked through that power purchase agreement so that I can make sure that whatever this transaction looks like, it's good for New Hampshire ratepayers. And the cost of Northern Pass is going to be $1.6 billion. What I want to make sure is that the New Hampshire ratepayer, and then that energy, 90% of that energy is going to end up in the ISO grid and be spread around the New England region. I want to make sure that New Hampshire ratepayers don't get burdened paying for $1.6 billion, and yet we don't get to keep the power associated with that.
Okay. Next question. Do you see any benefits of privatizing or leasing Cannon Mountain?
I do. I think that privatization, not unlike Sunapee, is probably is something that we should be looking at on a regular basis.
What other areas? We talk about here in New Hampshire, whether it's buildings that are unoccupied at this point. What resource are we not using to our benefit where you can point to and say, you know what, that makes sense? Jeannie Forster, for instance, yep. She's talking about, and this was born of a question that was asked,
So
for homeless veterans, people, victims of crime and things along those lines, we should be looking at renovating some of these old schools. And
I was going to go to schools is where I was going to go, because the problem we have is we've got a reducing, a shrinking population of students, and so we've got these large facilities and communities that we're going to need to redeploy. Honestly, my redeployment is to get them engaged probably in manufacturing operations. Can we convert these over to businesses that are going to create productive jobs in the communities?
Forrest wants to know, do you support school vouchers?
I do.
Okay, want to leave it? Well, talk about the debate a little bit more, though. I mean, because this is a big one in this race, whether we're talking about Common Core, vouchers, local control versus federal standards.
Absolutely. So love the concept and love the ideas of school choice. In fact, I home educated my own kids. My wife, Kathy, who is my wife of 30 years, and I, we have 7 children. We have home educated our kids. 3 of them are out of college, 2 in college, and I still got 2 at home. And I think we need to focus on school choice as an option to begin to solve some of the problems that we're having with the reducing student population so that we can continue to deliver an education to students. But the other thing that's important here is we have been using an institutional cookie cutter model of education for more than 100 years. And in the 21st century, we need to change that. And school choice is what will help to drive some of those improvements into the school system so that we have personalized education for each student so that they can learn and acquire the skills that they need and the academic achievement that they need to be good citizens.
Pete wants to know what your plans are for returning veterans in regards to healthy employment and reducing veteran homelessness.
Yeah, so if you are a vet, then you should contact me because I have 2 veteran employment and employment training opportunities right now that, believe it or not, we've been advertising them and we have not gotten the response that I imagined that we would, that are going to train veterans for advanced manufacturing jobs, particular CNC machining. So if you're a veteran out there and you're looking for an employment opportunity, please contact me because we've got programs in place now.
There you go. Benjamin wants to know, what's your stance on climate change?
So I do think that we've seen that the Earth is potentially warming up some, but we don't know that it's man-made. We don't know what the cause of it is, and I want to be very careful that we don't disrupt our economy, trying to chase after something. I've read a number of the reports that have been through the congressional hearing offices, mm-hmm. And what I've found is that there's a lot of variability in terms of these models, so we don't necessarily know where this is going.
Okay, next question. We'll lighten it up a little bit. What's your favorite part of New Hampshire? Cassie wants to know.
The top of Mount Monadnock.
All right.
Favorite spot.
How many times have you climbed?
Oh, countless.
All right. Next question. And you kind of touched on this, but we'll do it again. How has your previous life experience affected the way you will attempt to lead New Hampshire?
Yeah, so I think actually my experience is going to be really good because I have been the CEO of a global company, so I know how to run a large, complex organization, but I've also served in the legislature. And so I will be able to take some of the tools that I learned in business and bring them into government, but not everything from business transfers over. There are some, differences. And so my experience in the legislature has showed me that there's some of these tools that are different, and you have to bring over what works and you leave behind what doesn't so you can get things done.
As is to Jeannie Forster this week, you've been in the legislature. If you could wave a magic wand and change one thing about New Hampshire government, what would it be?
I have no idea.
Yeah. No, she said, biannual sessions makes more sense, especially since it's still largely
volunteer. Biannual session, we used to have that before, and we're not there now, so that may be something that would work well for, I'm not sure if I would agree with that or not, but I'm happy to entertain that as an option.
Okay. Next question, coming from So you get a lot of repeat folks out there. I can see that you're engaged. So
come on, guys.
That's a good thing. stay with me for a second. When obviously, when you're out there talking to folks, do you feel like that they are tying a lot of what you say and your message to the national, the top of the ticket in the presidential race? Just curious.
I do think that they are. I do think that people are looking at this very holistically. And we have to do that because a lot of the policies from the federal government over the last 8 years have harmed New Hampshire. And in many ways, what's happened is, you know, we've given up control. We've ceded control of our own state so that New Hampshire is basically just taking orders from Washington. And there's a lot of policies that need to be developed locally and implemented locally. And we've not been focusing on that. We've been, you know, executing the national agenda.
How's your family holding up during the campaign?
They're loving it.
Are they?
Yes.
Okay. Even with record low unemployment in New Hampshire, Josh wants to know, there is underemployment and lower wages in neighboring states. What is your plan? We touched on this a little bit, but it doesn't hurt to repeat a little bit. What is it? What's your plan to increase wages and?
Yep. Again, creating an environment in which businesses want to invest and grow jobs, and that involves making sure that, you know, the people who are available to work have the opportunity to get the skills to engage in a 21st century economy, working on healthcare costs, which are the highest in the country, working on electric rates, which we've talked about, and we've touched on that already, with fourth highest. You know, taxes are still the highest in all of New England, and we've got regulations that are just burdening us.
I'm surprised it took so long to get this question. You said you had three kids already out of college?
I do.
All right, so you know what it's like. How do you think you could help our kids go to college when it keeps getting harder with the cost and they're getting out and just, you know, debt, it's a mountain?
Right. So actually, part of the, you know, that first area that I talk about in terms of skills is trying to work on the education system. Today in our education system, we've got a fixed component and we've got a variable component. The fixed component is you've got to do in high school 4 years, 180 days a year. The variable component is, did you learn anything, A, B, C, D, F? We've got these flipped upside down because there's some kids who are going to be able to move through high school and they may be able to finish in, you know, two, three and a half years, finish the requirements for high school and then pull in some of these lower cost, less expensive community college classes and engage those so that when they come out of high school, they've already got college credits under their belt. They may even be trained to walk into a profession. That's what I'd really like to see is work with the community colleges, with the high schools, so that these kids can learn training in advanced manufacturing, walk out of high school and walk into a potentially high paying job, a $45,000, $55,000 a year job. And those kids who take those kinds of positions, all of the businesses that I've spoken to, you know, if that student gets there and they're working and they're doing a good job and they say, like, I love this, I want to become an engineer, well, the business will help support that effort, their college expansion, you know, help them go to night classes and take part-time classes, get their engineering degree, and they may be able to finish their engineering degree with no debt at all.
So you're talking about a complete change to the formula.
I do think that we have to change the model, right? We're still working with this cookie-cutter approach and it's not working for us.
No, this is for the Facebook users right now, but we'll definitely talk more about that.
Thank you.
That change right there. Next question, and social issue, but it is in the news a lot.
Yes.
How have you dealt with transgender bathroom issues with one of your companies? And if not, how would you approach this problem?
So I've not had to because it hasn't affected private industry. Okay. You know, we have not done that. And we've not, and honestly, it's not become a problem. We've never even encountered it in any of the businesses that I've been involved in. What I will not do is I will not put, you know, our young ladies and our young men in jeopardy by commingling sexes. I just think that's wrong.
Would you file a suit against the federal government like some states have?
I would probably, you know, I don't know if we need to go there. What I would do is, I don't know if we need to implement that. I mean, you're talking about in the school system now or in businesses?
The question is what the question is, but obviously it was born of what we're seeing on the national stage with the changing of the rules.
Yes, so I will push back and I will not allow the federal government to dictate local New Hampshire bathroom policy. If you think about where we are, Josh, we've got a federal government. We've got massive problems on a federal level. We've got $19 trillion in debt. You know, we've got big problems on the international scene, and this is the problem that they come up to work on. I think we can handle that ourselves.
Don, would you be open to creating a committee to seek foreign companies that might relocate and do business in New Hampshire?
I would absolutely. You know, and I can tell you that I personally will go to Montreal and try and recruit businesses down so that they come and they locate us, particularly in our North Country.
Okay. Next question. And we're going to end on this because we're just about out of time, and it's kind of a long question, and it touches on what you mentioned a moment ago. As governor, would you continue to fight against the placement of Syrian refugees in New Hampshire until the federal government assures us that they've been properly and thoroughly vetted for security concerns? Because that's, even on the other side of the aisle, Governor Hassan said, need to hit the pause button a while back and until we can assure that, you know.
So I'm concerned about two things, you know, both the vetting in terms of whether or not these are criminal elements we're inviting into our communities, and there has to be a health vetting as well. And so I think we need to make sure that that is done so that when we bring people into our communities, we're not putting at jeopardy our own population.
Okay. Well, you're very succinct with your answers. We might have time for one more before we squeeze it in here. But we might not either. So out on the trail, what surprised you most about running for governor? 45 seconds. Thanks, guys. Go ahead.
Yeah. So what surprised me the most is how engaged everybody is. It's so nice to go into communities and people care about the issues that are affecting New Hampshire. They are knowledgeable about those issues, which really makes it difficult on candidates in the sense that I need to be broadly knowledgeable about all these issues as well.
Sure,
but I appreciate
right
there are a whole bunch of engaged people who know what the issues are and they have good ideas to help move the state forward. You know, I want to find a way to harness that to be able to help move the state forward.
All right. Well, best of luck to you moving forward. Thank you for joining us on Facebook Live. I told you it was going to be rapid fire.
That was rapid fire.
And all over the map, right?
It was all over the map, too.
I can't keep up. Thank you guys for all your participation. We appreciate it. Be back here again next week, I believe on Monday, with Ted Gatzis running for governor as well. Thanks for joining us.